Let's begin by singing a hymn of praise to this our God, number 196. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, King of creation.
Thank you.
We bow before you in the quiet of this morning hour, and we draw near in need to praise and to adore you. And our hearts are filled with gladness, such gladness to know you, the God who so gently, so constantly sustains us. The God whose goodness and mercy daily attends us, surrounds us, and whose power does break forth as light to scatter all evil, all the terror of darkness, and to assure us of your great mercy towards us. It's right that we praise you, Lord. You are our God. And gladly we bow before you in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our great Saviour, our Redeemer. So hear us, Lord, this morning as we pray, as we draw near in his great name. Grant us your blessing, we pray, because we come to seek your face, seek your blessing upon us. And so, God, whose never failing providence orders all things, both in heaven and on earth, we humbly beseech you to put away from us harmful things and to give us those things which are profitable for us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, a warm welcome indeed to all of you this morning. If you're visiting with us over this holiday weekend, you're particularly welcome. We hope you feel at home with us and at one with us as a gathering of the Lord's people here. Let me draw your attention to these notice sheets you have. The front page tells you about all our services today. If you come back and join us again this evening, as we meet here at 6:30. One thing not on there, and that is that today there's a Release the Word Leavers lunch. That's going to be held at the Kelvin Grove building at 1 o'clock for 1:30. So go on down there after the service. If that involves you, if you're one of the leavers from Student Release the Word this year. In the middle pages, you'll see there the details on the right-hand side about the week ahead, numbers of things going on. Remember the women's breakfast. I think there's a little flyer in there again this coming Saturday morning, 10 o'clock. Back page, reminding you to put in your diaries Wednesday the 30th of May. That's the last Wednesday of this month. We'll be having our annual congregational get-together to look back over the year past, to give thanks to God and to look ahead at all that's planned for this coming year. So do come along. It's an important time for the church family with updates on all kinds of matters that we need to know about. And always, I think, a time of real encouragement. You'll see there also next Sunday afternoon at 5, there's an opportunity to come along for a cup of tea and some home baking. As Edward says, perhaps there will be some nice home baking. You keep saying it often enough that maybe it'll materialize. I think it will. And it's just an opportunity for folks who've been coming for a little while, quite new to us here, come along, meet some of the staff and leaders, and just find out a little bit more about all the different things that go on in our church life together. So if that's you, come along. You're very welcome next Sunday afternoon. Then just at the bottom there, there's about the Robery family. We're looking forward to having them home for a couple of months of a brief home assignment in June and July. They're going to be travelling around back and forward, north and south, and across the Northern Ireland, seeing family and friends, but back and forward here, so they'll be with us almost every weekend, I think. And you'll see there are some dates there that they still need some accommodation. They've got various things booked up with numbers of us already. But if you're able to help with these dates here, either because you can have them to stay with you, or because maybe you're on holiday and your home is free, and the Rovers could use it for a week, then perhaps you get in touch with the church office this week. We're trying to finalise that and help you as much as we can. Well, I leave you to read the rest of these notices at your leisure. Do take note also of the insert about Simon and Joanna, up-to-date news about them as we pray for them very particularly this month. But do look at those and take these home. We're going to turn now to our Bible reading. And once again, we're with Paul. That is Paul Brennan, not the Apostle Paul. So we're going to Paul in the book of Daniel in the Old Testament, and that, if you have one of our church Bibles, you'll find on page 743, otherwise find our Bible. I am Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and we'll find Daniel just after that. We're going to read together Daniel chapter 6. It's a very well-known story, famous story, but sometimes these famous stories we don't know quite as well as we think. So let's read carefully, shall we, and see exactly what it is that the Lord is saying to us. It pleased Darius the king to set over the kingdom 120 satraps to be throughout the whole kingdom, and over them three presidents, of whom Daniel was one, to whom these satraps should give account, so that the king might suffer no loss. Then this Daniel became distinguished above all the other presidents and satraps, because an excellent spirit was in him. The king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Then the presidents and the satraps sought to find a ground for complaint against Daniel with regard to the kingdom. For they could find no ground for complaint or any fault, because he was faithful and no error was found in him. Then these men said, "We shall not find any ground for complaint against this Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God." Then the presidents and satraps came by agreement to the king and said to him, "O King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom, all the prefects and the satraps, the counselors and the governors are agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an injunction that whoever makes petition to any god or man for 30 days, except to you, O king, should be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the injunction and sign the document so that it can't be changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, cannot be revoked." Therefore, King Darius signed the document and injunction. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he went to his house, where he had windows in his upper chamber open towards Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had done previously. Then these men came by agreement and found Daniel making petition and plea before his God. And they came near and said before the king concerning the injunction, "O king, did you not sign an injunction that anyone who makes petition to any god or man within 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions?" The king answered and said, "The thing stands fast, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked." Then they answered and said before the king, "Daniel, who is one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, or the injunction you have signed, but makes his petition three times a day." Then the king, when he heard these words, was much distressed. He set his mind to deliver Daniel, and he labored until the sun went down to rescue him. Then these men came by agreement to the king and said to the king, "Know, O king, that it is the law of the Medes and the Persians that no injunction or ordinance that the king establishes can be changed." Then the king commanded, and Daniel was brought and cast into the den of lions. He declared to them, "May your God, whom you serve continually, deliver you." A stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, that nothing might be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. No diversions were brought to him, and sleep went for him. Then at the break of day, the king arose and went in haste to the den of lions. As he came near to where Daniel was, he cried out in a tone of anguish. The king declared to Daniel, "O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions?" Then Daniel said to the king, "O king, live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths, and did not harm me, because I was found blameless before him, and also before you, O king, have done no harm." Then the king was exceedingly glad. He commanded that Daniel be taken up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no kind of harm was found on him, because he had trusted his God. And the king commanded, and those men who had maliciously accused Daniel were brought cast into the den of lions, they, their children, and their wives. And before they reached the bottom of the den, the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones in pieces. And King Darius wrote to all the peoples, nations, and languages of Rome and all the earth, peace be multiplied to you. I make a decree that in all my royal dominion, people are to tremble and fear the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, enduring forever. His kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion shall be to the end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and earth. He who has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Amen. May God bless you. Fellows and musicians, play quietly now. There's an opportunity to ponder these things as we read our offerings for the Lord's word. We do thank you that we bow in your presence, that we have your ear, in whose hands all the issues of this world truly belong. As we hear news of rulers, presidents, prime ministers, kings, in many parts of the world strutting upon the stage, exhibiting their power, alas, often subjugating their people. We thank you, Lord, that the laws, even the means of the Persians, are as nothing in your sight. You are bound by no word of man. Your hands can never be tied, even by the greatest of this world's rulers. As we think of the elections in the land of Lebanon this weekend, the outcome of which may be so significant for the peace or otherwise of that region of the world. We think of grave decisions to be made over the international treaties concerning Iran in the coming days. We think of the ongoing ferment in Syria and Yemen and other parts of the Middle East. As we think of the ongoing dialogue and forthcoming discussions between the leader of North Korea, the President of the United States, and all these things, O God, where our hearts sometimes tremble. We thank you that we are reminded, even by what we've read this morning, above all of these things, beyond all of these things, lies your timeless kingdom, your justice, your sovereignty, and your ultimate certainty. Punish all that is evil, and to vindicate those whose trust and whose hope is in you. So help us, Lord, to see this world not only through our physical eyes, but with the wisdom and the light and the confidence that comes from the eyes of faith, to which heaven is indeed opened, and we might see your power to us who believe. And so as we open this word of yours to us this morning, may you open it to our hearts to strengthen us, encourage us, to challenge us and to direct us, that we also might be found faithful to you. And so on the day of your coming, we find glad rejoicing with great joy to welcome you as King and Lord of all. So hear us, and draw near to us, we pray, for we ask all in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we come to God's word, then we sing the hymn on the screens, Martin Luther's great hymn, A Safe Stronghold, Our God is Still.
Thank you. 6 is a great story, perhaps the most famous of all Bible stories. And it is wonderfully gripping, isn't it? It's a graphic story. It captures the imagination. The tension mounts, the pulse races. But let's be careful not to miss the real message of the story. Don't be so distracted by the lines you can see in the story that you miss the line you cannot see. The danger Daniel saw in the threat of the lion's den was, in actual fact, inferior to the danger he couldn't see with his eyes. There was an unseen lion that was prowling and ready to pounce. The Apostle Peter, in his first letter, describes this lion. He says, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." There is an unseen but very real enemy set against God's people. As we've seen in recent Sundays in the book of Daniel, the living God, the God of Daniel, is the sovereign God. He alone is sovereign, and he will have no rivals. Even the great kings of this world will have to reckon with that reality. First, as we saw Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar, they were forced to submit to his rule. They were confronted with his sovereign reign. Now, those were, in reality, small skirmishes in the great cosmic battle that has raged since Genesis chapter 3. And that is a battle that has only one outcome, namely the establishment of God's kingdom, his eternal kingdom to the very ends of the earth. But it's a battle that the devil himself will not give up. He is the great adversary of God's people. And here again in chapter 6 of Daniel, he seeks to bring down God's man. The devil lurks in the shadows of this chapter. He is the prowling lion. That was the lion that Daniel did see through the eyes of faith. And it was the lion that he, through his willingness to stand firm, defeated. His avoidance of the trap set by the invisible lion will ironically cast him into the den of very real lions. This is a story all about the very real opposition and threat that God's faithful servants have always faced and will continue to face. But it's also an encouragement to God's faithful servant today to maintain faithful obedience to God, even in the face of the prowling lion, the devil. It's an encouragement because our God is Daniel's God, and he is the sovereign God. And so the devil and his attempts to bring down God's people, to take down God's plans, will in the end fall flat, whether it's Nebuchadnezzar, or Belshazzar, or Darius, whether it's the Babylonian Empire, or the Medo-Persian Empire, or any empire since, all these will fall by the wayside. The kingdom of God alone will endure, because he can and does deliver his people. Well, let's get into the story. We'll look at it in four scenes, and seek to hear the lessons intended for the first readers, and the implications for us, you and I here today. So scene 1, verses 1 to 9, the ferocious opponents Daniel faced. The ferocious opponents Daniel faced. And we see here in these opening verses that God's faithful servants are an easy target for the enemy. Now a lot has changed since we were last in the book of Daniel 2 weeks ago. Just 2 verses previous to this, Belshazzar was still on the throne. The Babylonian Empire was still just about intact. But all that came crashing down at the decree of the living God. God stripped Belshazzar not only of his kingdom, but of his very life. And for Belshazzar, it was all too late. And now, Babylon is in the hands of another king, another empire. Darius now reigns over the extended Mede and Persian Empire. Much has changed, but there's one man who remains, and it's Daniel. Now, the king, Darius, he quickly sets about organizing his new government, verse 1. He puts in place 120 satraps, and these would have been, I suppose, regional rulers, civil servants, local government officials, and revenue collectors. And over these satraps, he set three presidents. I guess these were the secretaries of state. But of all these officials, Daniel stood head and shoulders above them all. Look at verse 3. Then this Daniel became distinguished above all the other presidents and satraps, because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Daniel shouldered significant responsibility, didn't he? And he carried out his duties with such diligence and dignity and integrity that the king was going to promote him. He was going to make him the prime minister over Babylon. Now, it's worth just pausing for a moment and noting how Daniel went about his work in a hostile environment. Now, this isn't the key point of the text, but it's worth just pondering. Remember Daniel, he is a Jewish exile, taken from his home in Jerusalem, thrust into the very heart of Babylonian life. Now, Daniel didn't just throw up his arms and refuse to work. No, he used all the abilities God gave him. He worked hard. He served the authorities he now found himself under. But he didn't compromise. There were things that Daniel simply wouldn't do. But there was much he could do and did do. He worked very hard. He excelled. He rose to the top because of his integrity, because of his capabilities. And you and I, in our work, wherever that takes place, you and I are to be as faithful as Daniel was, with all the gifts and the abilities that God has given you. We are to use those. And as the new Living Christianity course, put together by the Christian Institute, puts it, our success at work is defined by our faithfulness to whatever God has called us to do. Our efforts have meaning and significance, not because we necessarily know how they fit into the intricate tapestry of God's eternal work, but because we do know that God weaves them together according to his eternal purpose. He uses whatever work we do for his purposes. So we work hard, don't we? Wherever we are, wherever God's put us, whatever abilities he's given to you, work hard, be faithful. Well, that was Daniel's attitude in his work in a hostile environment, and inevitably for him, it brought opposition. Look at verse 4. The other senior officials, they were presumably jealous at the upcoming promotion that was coming Daniel's way, and they wanted to bring him down. They wanted him out of the way. But the thing is, Daniel had not misled the House of Commons. There would be no resignation coming from his office. He was faithful. There was no ground for complaint against him. They couldn't find anything. Unless that is, they went for the one area they knew they could catch an arse on. You see, God's faithful servants are an easy target for the enemy. Look at verse 5. Then the men said, "We shall not find any ground for complaint against this Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God." They knew that given the choice between faithfulness to God and faithfulness to Darius, they knew that for Daniel, faithfulness to God would always have to win out. And so if they could create a situation, if they could make a scenario where Daniel would have to make that choice, well, they knew they could catch him out. They knew they would have their man. They would remove him from his office. And that is exactly what they do. Look on to verses 6 to 9. They come full of flattery to the king. "Oh, King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom, all the satraps, the prefects, the councillors and the governors, they are agreed." Well, that's a clear deception, isn't it? Where was Daniel in all of this? It's clearly not everyone who's in agreement. This preeminent civil servant has been left out of the discussion, but Darius can't see past the flattery. He never thought to ask, what does Daniel make of this? What does he think? He can't see it through the flattery. They say, "We all agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an injunction that whoever makes petition to any god or man for 30 days except you, O king, unless they do that, they'll be cast into the den of lions. Daniel was on the receiving end of fierce, vicious opposition. They plot against him. They seek to bring him down. They not only want him out of their way, they want him dead, thrown to the lions. And they knew exactly what Daniel would do if the conflict arose between faithfulness to God and faithfulness to Darius. And so they create that conflict. And that is often the pattern, the tactic of the enemy towards God's people. He puts in their path a choice of allegiance, either allegiance to this world or allegiance to the living God. Well, I wonder, would you and I make such an easy target for the enemies like Daniel? If our enemies were trying to find a way to catch us out, would they know to go for a similar line of attack that Daniel's enemies went for? Would those who oppose you take for granted your unbending fidelity to the living God? Would that be an assumption they would make? Suppose the scheme was something like, you know, just hold off church attendance for 30 days. Just take a month off. Would you think twice about that? Is there enough evidence of your faithfulness to God to trouble the enemy? Would he know where to strike you? It was clear for Daniel, wasn't it? They knew exactly how to get him. It is clear for you and I, I wonder. For me, it's a probing thought, isn't it? You see, if you're not really a faithful servant, if you're just a casual bystander in Christian life, then this doesn't really apply to you. The enemy has no need to take aim at you. You're no threat to him. But if you are a faithful servant, not perfect, but faithful, if you are a faithful servant, then be prepared to stand firm against the attacks that might come. Be prepared for that moment of choice between loyalty and allegiance to God, or loyalty and allegiance to the world. Well, that's the first scene, the ferocious opposition that Daniel faced. Let's look on to scene 2, verses 10 to 13, the faithful obedience Daniel maintained. We see here that God's faithful servants will persist in faithful obedience. Well, the trap has been set. The legislation signed. What would Daniel do? Well, look down at verse 10. And this really is the key moment in the whole chapter. You see, the point of trust, the point of victory for Daniel was not on the precipice of the lion's den, but rather was here, in the solitude of his upper room. This is where the battle was really won. Look there at verse 10. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he went to his house, where windows in his upper chamber opened toward Jerusalem. He got down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed, gave thanks before God as he had done previously. Daniel was fully aware of the plot against him. He knew the document had been signed. He knew the consequences of what he was about to do. He knew in all probability that he was being watched. He knew that this, for him, probably meant the end. He knew he'd be thrown to the lions. But he had no expectation that God would save him. Of course he knew that God could deliver him, but there was no expectation from Daniel that that would be the case. Daniel was prepared to persist in his faithful allegiance to the living God. He knew the choice he faced, and he stood firm. He stood firm against immense pressure. All were against Daniel. The power and intimidation of the full state machine was against him. The secret police were no doubt outside watching, keeping an eye. Great, great pressure. How tempting just to close those windows. How tempting just to think, hey, it's only 30 days, what harm can it do? But no, Daniel knew that his God was the sovereign God. And so the only thing he could do was remain loyal to him. This is the turning point of the story. This, here, verse 10, is where the battle was won. As one preacher puts it, the real miracle is not that Daniel got out of the lion's den, but rather that he was thrown in the first place. And that's right, isn't it? So often, the real miracles are not spectacular. Regular, ongoing, unspectacular obedience to God. That is the arena of real miracles. That's the real miracle here in Daniel chapter 6. It was that in the face of great opposition, certain death, the real miracle was that he prayed anyway. So when we watch Daniel being lowered there into the lion's den, we hold our breath, don't we? We anticipate what's going to happen. Yet by that point, the real danger had already passed. The real danger had already been overcome by this point. The great battle had been won. The great fight had been fought. As we said at the start, Daniel saw the greater danger. He knew where the real battle was to be fought. He knew that the devil was trying to destroy him and destroy his witness. And so he was willing to be thrown to the lions because that would mean escaping the jaws of the unseen lion, the prowling lion, the devil. His willingness to be thrown to them meant he escaped the unseen lion. And that for Daniel, well, that was the point of victory. That decision to pray regardless. And that is so for you and I today. Your greatest victories in life are not at the point of God's deliverance, but rather at the point of decision. Do you obey God and his word? Submit to him, or do you go with the way of the world? Do you submit to the world? Do you go with the flow? That's the key decision. Where does your loyalty rest when that moment of decision comes? The Christians in every age have suffered and even died because, like Daniel, they refused to compromise their allegiance to the living God. The Apostle James says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Submit to him. Resist the devil. He will flee from you. That was Daniel's stand. He resisted the devil. Will it be yours and mine? Will we take a stand like that? And resisting the devil, it may mean being thrown to the lions. But that is, from eternity's perspective, better by far. Seen from this world, it's a tragedy, but from eternity's perspective, from the real perspective, that is better by far. To resist the devil, be thrown to the lions. But note too that little phrase at the end of verse 10. Daniel prayed as he had done previously. This was Daniel's well-established habit of prayer. And by this point in the book, it is like if Daniel is in his 70s or even in his 80s. It's quite a thought, isn't it, that only once Daniel got to his 80s that his greatest test came. Daniel had faced plenty of tests before. Just read the opening chapters of the book. He's faced test after test. And we can, I think, tend to assume that the great tests of Christian experience come in the early days. But that may not always be the case. So if any of you here are in the first 8 decades of life, then this applies to you. It may be that the sternest test lies ahead. Daniel knew that all that had happened already in life, they were a preparation for this moment. But rather than view this as a moment where he opt out of faithfulness, relying on past faithfulness, no, he saw this as the climax of faithfulness. Sinclair Ferguson put it, past faithfulness was not meant to be a compensation for present faithfulness, rather, it was a preparation for more faithfulness. So yes, we've had as a fellowship, as a church, stern tests in the last decade or so. But there will no doubt be more to come. All that's happened in the past is a preparation for what's to come next, for what yet might be. Perhaps personally, you face great tests in your life and your faith. But there may be more yet to come. All that's happened already, all those moments of past faithfulness, they're preparation for what might yet be. Well, that was Daniel's experience. And it's been the experience of countless Christians down through the ages. And it may so be for you and I. So we've seen here then, the second scene, that God's faithful servants will persist in faithful allegiance. So scene 1, verses 1 to 9, the ferocious opponents that we faced. Scene 2, the faithful obedience Daniel maintained. And scene 3, the futile obstruction Darius attempted, verses 14 to 18. And we see here that God's faithful servants do sometimes suffer unfairly. So put not your trust in the powers of this world. Well, the trap has been set, and it works. They've caught their man in the act, and they triumphantly bring the news to the king in verse 13. And Darius, but he now realizes that he's been caught out. The man that he trusted, the man he was going to make prime minister, has been subject to the most vicious campaign, motivated by jealousy and hatred. Look at verse 14. The king is absolutely devastated. And he did what he could to obstruct his own decree. He worked until the sun set to deliver Daniel, but he couldn't do it. His efforts were futile. And like Herod and Pilate after him, Darius would find himself having to condemn an innocent man, to hand him over to certain death in order to keep face, to placate the crowds who were baying for blood. And the treatment that Daniel was on the receiving end of here was utterly unfair, wasn't it? He had been set up. He had done nothing wrong. And the legislation was totally deceitful and designed to catch him out. Desperately unfair. Sometimes God's faithful servants will suffer unfairly. Like Daniel, like John the Baptist, like Jesus himself. All innocent. All found guilty under trumped up charges. And there is no use, when those moments come, there's no use putting your trust and hope in the powers of this world. Even the great Darius, who realized to be caught out, who wanted to rescue Daniel, he couldn't. He couldn't deliver Daniel. He was utterly powerless. Look at him there in verse 18. He couldn't eat. He couldn't sleep. He was racked with guilt about what had befallen Daniel. So it may be that the rulers of this world are not personally hostile towards you. They may even favor you, but don't pin your hopes on them. They may be as helpless as Darius was. And although Darius couldn't deliver Daniel, God could and did. Even the most powerful of this world's institutions and men, they're powerless compared to the living God. So here's the lesson. Don't put your trust in men. Trust in God, for he alone, as we see now in our final scene, he alone delivers. So let's look on then to that final scene, verses 19 to the end. The foolish opposition exposed by Daniel's deliverance. And so we see here in this last scene that God's faithful servants need not fear the powers of this world, because God saves. Well, morning breaks, and Darius rushes to the lion's den in the morning. And he, like the reader, is none the wiser at this point. What has happened to Daniel? Is he still alive? Would he know the temporal deliverance that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego enjoyed decades earlier? Daniel's eternal deliverance can be in no doubt, can it? He remained faithful to the end, even in the most intense scrutiny. But would he survive the lion's den? Darius cries out, "O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you?" Then comes the reply that Darius longed to hear. "O king, live forever. My God sent his angel, shut the lion's mouth. I've not been harmed, because I was found blameless before him. Daniel is delivered. Not a scratch was to be found on him. And he was delivered," end of verse 23, "because he trusted in God." That moment in verse 10, when he prayed on regardless, that moment of trust, that is what delivered him. It wasn't because the lions weren't hungry. Because the next verse, a very sobering and gruesome verse, isn't it? Daniel's adversaries, those who sought to trap him and bring him down, they themselves, well, they're caught in their own trap. They're thrown to the lions. And before they even reach the bottom of the pit, the lions overcome them. They destroy them. So it wasn't that the lions weren't hungry. It was that the living God delivered Daniel. And this shows us, doesn't it, the utter foolishness of opposing God and God's people. There's a total mismatch going on here. Despite having the full weight of the Persian Empire behind them, Daniel's adversaries were trapped by their own plan, totally ironic. And that is how it will be for all God's enemies if they continue to oppose him, to oppose his church and his people. And it may be for those who oppose God and his people, it may be that they will face defeat in this life, like these guys did. But if they don't face the reality in this life, then they certainly will on that awesome day of judgment that will surely come. Man's foolish opposition will be exposed one day. And so you and I, we can know that none can harm us as we stand in Christ, because he has defeated through his death, his resurrection, our greatest and most fearsome opponents, our great enemies have been dealt with. Those things that we fear most, they have no hold over us in the end. And that is not to say that we are guaranteed to avoid hardship. It's no guarantee that we'll avoid suffering or even death in this life if we take a stand like Daniel did. But this life is not all there is. And so the deliverance that Daniel knew, all who trust in Christ, all who trust him, will know that deliverance too one day. It may not be in this life, but certainly on the day of Christ, when he returns, we will know that deliverance. We will know without a doubt the deliverance that Daniel knew. It's a sure thing. And on that day, the great powers of this world, the Babylonians, the Medes and Persians, the powers that strike fear into your heart and mine, they will be seen for what they really are on that day. And they will be powerless, utterly powerless, in the face of the living God who is the King of the universe. God will deliver his people on that day. And it's a deliverance that has been won because Jesus Christ, one more innocent than Daniel, one who was found guilty of trumped up charges, one who had not put a foot wrong, he wasn't kept from the grave. He wasn't spared the agonies of an execution. But as one writer put it so well, the jaws of the lion could not and did not hold him. And the stone was rolled away to show a greater miracle than the preservation of Daniel, to show that death had already given up its prey. Christ overcame death. And this is God's way of deliverance for his people. The innocent suffered, defeated death once and for all, so that the guilty may go free. The only truly innocent man ever walked this earth. He wasn't spared the judgment that rightly should come to us. And that is why you and I can stand firm today, even against the fiercest opposition, even the full weight of the state, when they're arrayed against us, you and I can stand firm. Not because we're particularly courageous, but because of God's sure promise of deliverance. It's sealed in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our God is a saving God, a God who delivers those who trust him. And as we trust him, as you trust him, we know that nothing can touch us, not death, not the devil, nothing can touch us. In him alone, we have a certain hope of everlasting life. So the prowling lions that we will inevitably encounter at some point in life, the lions that we can see, and the lion that we cannot see, they need not strike fear into our hearts, because we know there is one who has delivered us from their grasp. He's done it. It's a sure thing. So trust him. In Christ alone, our hope is found. He is our light, our strength, and our soul. Amen. Shall we sing the words of that hymn? On the screen, Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my soul. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm with a fierce sprout and storm. Let's sing together before we come to the community.
Yeah.
the Beloved writes, as we gather here, we should remember this sacrament is a memorial of the great sacrifice of Christ for the sins of men. A sacrifice that, as we were thinking about us this morning, a sacrifice that guarantees deliverance from all of our enemies. It's a sacrament that is a true means of grace for those who trust in Him. Communion is a visible word. It is a promise that we can touch. And God knows that we, as physical creatures, we need physical signs and seals. He knows that we're not superhuman. He knows that we need these solid, real things to touch. And so not only reminds us, but also assures us of the reality of the gospel as we taste the bread and as we drink the wine. But this sacrament is also a bond and a pledge of our union with Him and with each other as members of His body. Therefore, it is necessary as we come, it's necessary that we come with knowledge, faith, repentance, and love, not holding fellowship with evil, or cherishing pride or self-righteousness, but conscious of our weakness, conscious of our sorrow for our sins, humbly putting our trust in God, hungering and thirsting after Him and seeking His grace. And all who come in that way with humble trust and a love for the Lord and Saviour, all who do so are welcome at this His table. And this His table, it is not our congregation's table, it's not any denomination, but it's His, the Lord's table. And so it is He who invites you to it here this morning. Therefore let no one hinder you, least of all your own heart, on account of sin or a sense of your own unworthiness. Long ago, it was said scornfully by censorious religious people, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." Well, yes, he did. And he's going to do so again today with us this morning. For he said, "I've come not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." So draw near then to the holy table and hear the gracious words of our Lord Jesus Christ that He speaks to all who come humbly. "Come to me," He says, "all you who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy and my burden is light." Jesus also said, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. The one who comes to me I will by no means cast out." And hear the words too of the institution of the supper of our Lord Jesus as they are delivered by the Apostle Paul. "I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, saying, 'This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, as the Lord took bread and wine, and we likewise take these simple elements to be set apart for the holiness of which he appointed them, as we do this, let's give thanks and draw near to the throne of grace and present God with our prayers and thanksgiving." Let's pray. Our Father God, how we thank you for the wonder of your gospel. The great gospel that has been accomplished as we look back at all the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the foretaste of that gospel we've seen in the saving purposes in the story of Daniel, and seen fully in the death, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for the absolute certainty of that deliverance that you have guaranteed for all who trust in you. Thank you that you are a God who delights to save and rescue sinners like us. So we are full of praise and thankfulness that you would save unworthy folk like us. And so we thank you. And Lord, we also look forward with great and joyful anticipation of all that's to come. We know that we're not exempt from life's trials. We know that there is much pain and suffering in this life. But how we thank you that we can look forward with real joyful anticipation to the full riches of the deliverance that will come. The hope of everlasting hope is a sure and certain hope. And so we thank and praise you that one day we will all be with you in the new creation for all eternity. And thank you that you give us real and present assurance of that great reality, that we enjoy union with you, that you are with us, that your presence is with us in our midst this morning. Thank you for all that we can enjoy now because of our union with Christ. As we sung, there is no guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. No power of hell, no scheme of man can pluck us from your hands. Thank you for the great assurances of your gospel. And so, conscious of your presence within us and among us by your Spirit, may we together truly feed in our hearts by faith. For Christ, our Saviour's sake, we ask it. Amen. Well, according then to the holy institution, the example and the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, and for a memorial of him and what he did for us, we now do this. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, as I do now. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so I invite the servants to come and take the elements and to pass them around. And as they come, take and eat the bread, but hold the wine and dish in communion at the end. Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. This my blood, which is shed for was often, as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's drink together the communion. Let's pray. And Father, how we thank you for the great certainty of your great gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. As surely and as certainly as we've tasted this bread and drunk this wine, so surely as Christ washed our sin away, defeated our enemies, and brought us everlasting life. Thank you for this great, certain hope of the gospel, and help us that we can be with people to stand firm because you are with us and in us, by your Spirit. Help us to stand firm before you answer it. In Jesus' name. We close our time together by singing the hymn in our books on the night. And now to him whose power is able to check our stumbling feet, prepare our souls for glory, bear with joy our King's in the mind. Fellowship, the Holy Spirit, be with you all now and evermore.